Hey, let's briefly go over the physiology of the duodenum and the sphincter of Oddi. There's not too much that's really relevant to know, so it's going to be a brief lecture. Okay, so the duodenum has two sort of primary functions. Number one, it needs to neutralize all the acid spilling into it before that acid reaches the jejunum, and it needs to move chyme from the pylorus of the stomach to the jejunum. So let's focus on the acid buffering function. So duodenum doesn't really absorb much in terms of nutrients, unlike the jejunum and the ileum. So its main function is not absorptive, as of the other parts of the intestines, but mainly to be the buffer zone, whereby it takes stomach acid with a pH of 1 or 2 and makes it alkaline or neutralized pH 7 to 8 by the time it hits the jejunum. And how does it do this? Well, it does it by secreting bicarbonate. And secreted by duodenal epithelial cells, and these bicarbonate ions react with hydrochloric acid to make water, salt, and CO2 as byproducts. Most of the water and salt and CO2 are reabsorbed. I'm assuming some of it will escape into the stomach and help you with burping, but the convention is that most of it is reabsorbed and then recycled to make more bicarbonate. Because bicarbonate is in fact made from the reaction of CO2 and water. CO2 and water make carbonic acid, and then if you take the hydrogen ion away from carbonic acid, you get bicarbonate. And this bicarbonate is mostly secreted by Brunner glands, and it's often secreted with mucus, leading to a sort of intestinal lining of this alkaline mucus layer. Okay, other functions of the duodenum, it works as a gastric brake. In other words, if you have a lot of acid in the stomach or if you have a very fatty meal that enters the duodenum, then duodenum is going to cause reflexive delay in gastric emptying, partly through neuronal feedback, partly through hormonal feedback, such as peptide-YY. The mechanism, to be honest, is not clearly understood, but when there's a lot of fat in the duodenum and as the contents is quite hyperosmolar, or there's too much acid in the duodenum, the stomach will slow down emptying into the duodenum. The other functions are to activate trypsin, secreted by the pancreas. We have enteropeptidase enzymes at the brush border of the duodenum, and they convert trypsinogen to trypsin, the active form, and that helps to activate all the other protein enzymes, and it also breaks down proteins in and of itself. So it's ready for absorption by the time it reaches the jejunum. And various hormones are secreted by the duodenum, so duodenum can actually be seen as an endocrine organ. It secretes cholecystokinin, which triggers off contractions of bile ducts and the gallbladder, and secretion of pancreatic enzymes. Secretin stimulates secretion of bile and pancreatic juice, and peptide YY, which has effects on the stomach and feelings of fullness. Okay, so in the duodenum we have the ampulla of Vater, and the ampulla of Vater is an opening that allows bile and pancreatic juice into the duodenum. It's controlled by a muscle called the sphincter of Oddi. And we can say that the sphincter has three functions. As I mentioned, it regulates flow of bile and pancreatic juice into the duodenum. In between meals it's closed, but the liver is constantly making bile, so as the bile hits this closed sphincter, it's diverted back and upwards into the gallbladder, filling up the gallbladder reservoir in between meals. And also we want to avoid duodenal contents going into the bile and pancreatic ducts, because that's going to predispose to infection. All those bacteria that live in the duodenum can then enter into the bile ducts and trigger off bile duct stones, for example. Okay, so how does the sphincter of Oddi work? The sphincter is actually a network of circular and longitudinal smooth muscles that surround the ampulla of Vater, and also surrounds the distal common bile duct and the distal pancreatic duct. So in general, the sphincter is contracted, so it clamps down at the hepatopancreatic duct, preventing reflux from the duodenum into the ducts. It clamps the distal common bile duct, preventing bile from entering the duodenum or the pancreatic duct, and then the bile is diverted back into the gallbladder ducts and into the gallbladder eventually, and it also clamps on the distal pancreatic duct, forcing pancreatic juice to remain within the pancreas and not allowing it into the bile ducts or into the duodenum. So that's as this paragraph basically is just what I've just explained. Okay, when the duodenum secretes cholecystokinin, this causes relaxation of the sphincter, and then common bile duct opens up, allowing bile to flow in. The pancreatic duct opens up, allowing pancreas juice to flow, and then the ampulla fata opens up, and everything flows out due to the influence of cholecystokinin. Okay, so if these muscles are constantly contracted, they need a nerve supply to constantly make them contract. So the innervation is intrinsic and extrinsic. Intrinsic is the outer myenteric plexus and the submucosal plexus. Extrinsic supplies from the vagus nerve, and from sympathetic nerves from the superior mesenteric ganglion. And these are my references. It's quite hard to find decent information on the duodenum in any textbook. It's a somewhat neglected organ in physiology textbooks, but I managed to find some fairly decent scientific articles on the functions of the duodenum.